Hello again, it's Kyle with a video comparing Texas to Florida, and they're our second and third most populous state in the country. Right now you can look on YouTube and there are a bunch of videos of Texas comparing itself to California, but Californians don't care about Texas. They're unlikely to compare themselves to Florida, the other state with the sunshine and the beaches and the beautiful people, but Floridians don't care about California, and you rarely see anything comparing Texas to Florida. And they're actually quite comparable. They both extend into the subtropics. They both have a lot of severe thunderstorms that face a significant hurricane threat, and they bookend the South. I live in the South, and something you'll hear people talk about is whether or not these two states are Southern. So in this video, I want to compare these two powerhouses. I want to compare the cities, the natural landscapes, the economy, the taxes, the food, the music, the agriculture, and the sports. Look at a wide range of categories to finally get down to the bottom of this. Which state is better? It's Texas versus Florida. I'm going to start off by comparing various cities in each state, and they all have high crime, they all have a lot of traffic and congestion, but you think about the things that are important to people that live in the city and why they live there and not the countryside. And you know, the things they care about are the cultural aspects that make a city a city. So we're talking about the bright lights, the excitement, the restaurants, the shopping, the nightlife, those types of things that why people want to put up with the negative things and live in the city. I'm going to start off by comparing the largest metro areas in each state. So we're talking the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex versus the Miami-Fort Lauderdale metro area, and move on from there. The Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex has over 6 million people, but in my opinion, it's one of the most boring big cities in the country. There just isn't a whole lot of excitement going on there. And if you're a visitor, there really isn't a whole lot to do. Downtown's all right, uptown's all right, and there's a pretty cool neighborhood called Deep Ellum, which is worth checking out, but there just really isn't a whole lot to see. Fort Worth, in my opinion, is a little bit nicer, but it's also kind of bland. There's a touristy area called the Stockyards, which is pretty interesting, and you get the world's largest bar there called Billy Bob's. That's certainly worth checking out, but overall, Dallas-Fort Worth really isn't that terribly exciting. Miami, on the other hand, is quite the opposite. It's one of the most exciting and vibrant cities in America, and certainly one that you're going to want to visit. Got a lot of great restaurants and bars. It's incredible nightlife. There's always a party going on there. The cultural aspects of the city are fantastic. You got those beautiful beaches and those beautiful people. Fort Lauderdale is a little more subdued, but there's also some really nice beaches there. Some pretty cool neighbors worth checking out. So if you're going city versus city, I got to take Miami over Dallas and give this one to Florida. Next up, I'll be comparing the second largest metro area in each state. So that's the Tampa Bay area versus the Houston area. And kind of like Miami, Tampa is a very exciting city. There's a lot going on, a lot of great restaurants and nightlife. Ybor City is quite the party spot. It's a lot of fun to be hanging out there. St. Petersburg has also got some pretty cool cultural attractions there. The Salvador Dali Museum is great. The beaches there are fantastic, with St. Pete Beach and Clearwater Beach being pretty cool. So overall, Tampa Bay metro area is a pretty cool city. Houston doesn't offer the same level of excitement as the Tampa Bay area, but I do think Houston's a lot nicer than Dallas and much more interesting as a place to visit. Downtown's pretty cool. The NASA Center is a great place to hang out. And there are some pretty cool neighborhoods there as well. The Montrose area is the cool hipster part of town where all the cool kids hang out. But Galveston Beach is kind of cheesy. It's very, I don't know, kind of tacky, kind of like Myrtle Beach. So I'm not really a big fan of Galveston Beach. And although Houston's pretty cool, I don't think it can quite compare to Tampa Bay. So again, I'm going to give the vote to Florida on this one. Continuing with my city comparison, next up is San Antonio versus Orlando. And I like San Antonio. It's a pretty cool spot to hang out. It's very touristy. The Alamo might be a little underwhelming if you're expecting something big and grand. And it's right in the middle of downtown, so it's kind of surprising the setting it's in. The Riverwalk is very touristy, but it's also kind of neat to see because there's really nothing else like that in the U.S. And I really like the Market Square area. It's very historic and got some cool Mexican restaurants and a Mexican craft shop. So overall, I think San Antonio is worth checking out and a pretty nice city. Compare that to now Orlando. And how am I going to put this delicately? I mean, I hate Orlando. It's probably my least favorite big city in the country. I just really don't like this place. If you don't have kids, there's really no reason to go anywhere near Orlando. If you do have kids, I guess it's maybe worth a once-in-a-lifetime pilgrimage type of thing, but it really is not that terribly interesting of a city, and it's not that terribly exciting either. My wife got her PhD from the University of Central Florida in Orlando, and I spent a lot of time there, and I got to really learn to hate the place. So I got to give the easy win to San Antonio on this one. This is a much nicer place than Orlando, so Texas with the win here. Next in line, we have Jacksonville versus El Paso. And these two cities are actually kind of similar. They're about the same size. The metro area is about the same size. And they're each at the corner of their own states. And they're often kind of forgotten. And a little bit different than the rest of the cities in the state. Jacksonville is a little unique. And it's the part of Florida where you're least likely to experience a hurricane. But it's also kind of boring. There really isn't a whole lot going on there. It doesn't kind of have the same party atmosphere that you have in the other Florida beach cities. And, you know, it's just kind of bland. And Jacksonville Beach is okay, but this really isn't compared to the other beaches in Florida. El Paso is quite a bit different from the rest of Texas, and it's way far away from any other population center in the state. It's in the mountain time zone, has a dry climate. In fact, it has one of the best climates in the entire country. No humidity, no hurricanes. It's great. You have some beautiful mountains outside of the city as well. So if you're doing a cross-country road trip on I-10, there's a pretty good chance you're going to be stopping in El Paso and want to do a short hike. There's some nice state parks right outside the city. Historic area right downtown. There's some really cool murals you can check out. So overall, El Paso is quite a bit better than Jacksonville. Easy win for Texas here. Next up, I'll be comparing the state capitals of each state, and this isn't really a fair comparison in that Austin's a lot bigger than Tallahassee, but size isn't everything. But downtown Austin's pretty cool. 6th Street is one of the most exciting streets in the country. A lot of bars, a lot of great nightlife and live music going on. The state capitol building there is, as you would expect in Texas, is huge, pretty grand, and also one of the best ones to see in the country. I love the Conga Street Bridge and the bat flight you can see going on there. I think it has grown too much too fast for its own good, and infrastructure hasn't quite kept up with the growth there, but there's a reason why a lot of people are moving to Austin. It's just a pretty cool place. Tallahassee is surprisingly small considering it's the state capital of a huge state, and it's also surprisingly boring considering it's the home of two major universities. But the thing I like the least about Tallahassee is that it's got a really ugly state capitol building. There's an old historic part there, which is all right, but the rest of it is just a high-rise office complex that's really ugly. And there are other high-rise state capitals in the country. Nebraska and Louisiana come to mind, but those are nice-looking buildings. The one in Florida is ugly, so this one's an easy win for Austin here. And the last cities I'll be comparing are Key West and South Padre Island. These are east of southern tips of their states, extend well into the subtropics, and they're both pretty well known for its party atmosphere. Key West is a very unique place. There's nothing else quite like it in the U.S. It's a really funky place to hang out. A lot of cool shops and restaurants and a wonderful nightlife, and it's well known for just being very aloof when it comes to hurricanes. So Key West is one of the true, just iconic spots in Florida, really in America. Unlike Key West, there's nothing that stands out about South Padre Island. It's got really nothing unique compared to some of the other beach resort towns along the Gulf Coast. There's still a party scene there, but there's a lot more bros and bras hanging out there. It's just not quite the same as the unique aspect and the flair you're going to get in Key West. So it's a pretty cool place to hang out, but in this category, I got to give the easy win to Key West. Next up, I'm going to talk about the economic aspects of each state to include the GDP, the economic power, the tax rate, the companies are headquartered there, and the agriculture. So essentially, we're talking about the money here. Florida has an overall GDP of just under $1 trillion, which is a lot of money. It's a number 4 state in terms of overall GDP, but compare that to New York, which has less people than Florida, but has a $1.6 trillion GDP. So Florida has a smaller percentage of the U.S. GDP than its percentage of the population. So let's be honest here, Florida isn't really pulling its weight in terms of GDP. Texas, on the other hand, has a GDP of $1.7 trillion, which makes it the second largest economy in the U.S. and has well more than 1.5 times the GDP of Florida, even though it doesn't have 1.5 times the population. So Texas is pulling its weight with 9% of the U.S. population and 9% of the U.S. GDP. So Texas also has a much higher GDP per capita than Florida. So in terms of GDP, Texas gets the easy win on this category. Now let's look at some of the companies that are headquartered in each state. Texas has ExxonMobil, Phillips 66, Valero Energy, AT&T, American Airlines, Dell Computers. These are all huge companies that are a really important part of the American economy. Florida, on the other hand, is the corporate headquarters to Publix grocery stores, Olive Garden, Cheddar's, Outback Steakhouse, Longhorn Steakhouse, ironically enough, Walt Disney Company, Royal Caribbean Cruise Lines, Carnival Cruise Lines. So, I mean, you might like these restaurants and cruise lines, but the companies headquartered in Florida are nowhere near as important as the ones headquartered in Texas. Texas gets the easy win in this category. And now let's talk about taxes for each state. Both of these states have zero state income tax, but there's a lot more taxes that you pay than just income tax. Florida has a fairly low sales tax at 6.5%, and you don't pay sales tax on services or things that are non-tangible. You also have a middle-of-the-road property tax rate, pretty low gas tax as well. So Florida gets a lot of its revenue from hotel occupancy taxes, so tourists are paying for a lot of the stuff going on in Florida. Texas is not the low-tax state a lot of people think it is. It has just about the highest property taxes in the U.S., has a very high sales tax at over 8%, and you pay sales tax on everything, including services and things are not tangible. It also has a very high gas tax. And even though the overall gas prices are fairly low in Texas, it's because a lot of your gas comes from Texas, but a lot of what you're paying for are the taxes. So overall, Texas is really kind of middle of the road when compared to other states in terms of tax burden. Florida gets the easy win in this category. And now let's talk about agriculture for each state. Texas is the number two state in overall agriculture with a total combined value of about $16.5 billion. It's number four in overall crop production among states and is by far number one in terms of livestock production. And livestock is about two-thirds of total Texas agriculture. So Texas, quite the agricultural powerhouse. Florida's total agricultural output is about $7 billion and ranks number five in the U.S. in total crop output, most famously oranges and orange juice. About 80% of its total agriculture is in crops, so Florida is certainly no agricultural slouch, but doesn't come anywhere near close to competing with Texas. Next up, I'm going to compare the natural aspects of each state. You don't really think of majestic beauty when you think of Texas and Florida, but there are some really beautiful spots in each state, and I'm also going to talk about the natural disasters that affect each state. I'm going to start off by comparing the major national park of each state, so we're talking Big Bend versus the Everglades. And this one really tugs at my heartstrings because I really love both of these places. Big Bend is a gorgeous place in deep southwest Texas. It's one of the most lightly visited national parks in the country because it's nowhere near any major road. If you're doing a cross-country road trip along I-10, you're going to be nowhere near Big Bend, but I do recommend going out of the way to see it. I love going hiking and camping there. You're right along the Mexican border, and there's a spot where you can go across the river into Mexico and experience some authentic rural Mexican life. I also really love the Everglades. It's a beautiful national park as well. It's a great place to go canoeing or kayaking through the mangroves. You can go sea kayaking out in the more coastal areas. And South Florida in general is the only place in the world where you're going to see alligators and crocodiles coexisting in the wild. So it's pretty cool. It protects a really unique landscape. It's like nowhere else in the world. So for that reason, I got to give a nod to Everglades because it does protect somewhere that's like nowhere else on Earth. So as much as I love Big Bend, I got to give a nod to Florida on this one. In terms of natural disasters, Florida and Texas are two of the worst states in the country. Florida is, of course, the number one state for hurricanes, with the most number and the largest amount of damage due to hurricanes, and they're getting stronger and more frequent. And you don't have a large variety of hazards in Florida, you just have a lot of hurricanes. But you do also have sinkholes. You don't really hear about sinkholes too much, but they're pretty scary. So Florida has by far the highest homeowners insurance rates in the entire country, which is a pretty good indication of how bad the natural disasters are in the state. Texas has the seventh highest property insurance rates in the country, which is again a pretty good indication of how many hazards affect the state. And of course, you can get hurricanes happening in Texas, and they can be just as strong as the ones that happen in Florida. But unlike Florida, the vast majority of people in Texas don't live right along the coast or right near it. So not everyone is directly affected by a hurricane. But you do have a lot more severe thunderstorms that can do a lot more damage with high winds, incredibly large hail that can do some serious damage, and of course, giant tornadoes that can be really devastating. But with just the sheer number of hurricanes and devastating hurricanes that happen in Florida, I got to give the nod to Texas in this category, even though these two states are two of the worst in the country for them. All right, so now I want to compare the climate of each state. And both of these states face a lot of weather hazards, but fortunately, these don't happen on a day-to-day basis. South Texas has pretty much the same climate as the Florida Peninsula, but where they differ is that the interior portions of Texas get really, really hot during the summertime. Temperatures in the 90s are the norm, and temperatures in the hundreds are pretty common as well. And also during the wintertime, it can get pretty chilly in North Texas. I mean, no one's going to confuse Texas winters with Michigan or anything like that, but it can get pretty chilly in the Dallas area, and the Panhandle gets pretty cold during the winter. So Texas, you have a lot more extreme in the temperatures. Really hot during the summer and kind of chilly during the winter. Florida also has hot, humid, nasty summers, but they're not quite as hot and nasty as Texas. Temperatures in the upper 80s and lower 90s are more the norm, and temperatures in the hundreds are pretty rare. And during the winter time, it's really nice. It's the nicest time of the year for most of Florida. And maybe the Panhandle gets a little bit chilly, but the vast majority of people in Florida live on the peninsula where it stays really nice all winter. So no surprise here, Florida gets the easy win with comparing the climates. And now to compare the beaches of each state, and pretty much all of Florida is a beach. The vast majority of Floridians live along the coast, and you have a wide range of styles of beaches in Florida. You get the big cities and smaller towns, you get quiet beaches and busy ones. When you get to the south part of the state, you have that really clear water. It's almost like the Caribbean, so a lot of variety in the beaches in Florida. A lot of them are really beautiful, and there are some ones that are not so nice, but the vast majority of them are pretty cool. Florida, certainly well known for its great beaches. Texas also has some nice beaches along its Gulf Coast shoreline. I really like Malachite Beach right outside of Corpus Christi. You can camp right there on the beach. Padre Island National Seashore is pretty cool once you get north of the town of South Padre Island, but there really aren't that many great beaches in Texas, and you got some that really aren't that nice. And so big surprise here, Texas beaches can't quite compare to the Florida ones. In the beach category, Florida easily wins. And the last few categories I'm going to be comparing are some of the cultural aspects. So we're talking about food, music, and sports. And in the grand scheme of things, these aren't some of the most important categories compared to some of the others, but they can be a large source of local pride. And now for my favorite category, the food. And you really can't go wrong when talking about the food in either one of these states. Two of the most iconic items you'll find on menus in Florida include Cuban sandwiches and conch fritters. And I love Cuban sandwiches. I'll eat them at places you can get outside of Florida. And conch fritters is something you're not going to really see outside of the state. There aren't that many of them, and eating them is kind of ethically ambiguous, but they do taste really good. The menu in Texas is, of course, going to be dominated by beef, with barbecue beef brisket and chili con carne both being really good. You got Tex-Mex food, which is fantastic. So as much as I love seafood and the offerings in Florida, I got to give the easy win to Texas here in the food category. In terms of music, there have been all kinds of wonderful musical acts that have emerged from Texas. You've got country music legends Willie Nelson, Waylon Jennings, and George Strait, but it isn't all just country. You've also got blues legends Stevie Ray Vaughan, Bootylicious Beyoncé, hip-hop great Chamillionaire, classic rock legend ZZ Top. So you could just go on and on listing great musicians that have come out of Texas. From Florida, you've got Ray Charles, Tom Petty, Lynyrd Skynyrd, Gloria Estefan, and Jimmy Buffett. It's just some serious heavy hitters in the world of music, but the big difference is I could just go on and on listing Texas musicians, but if I were to name any more from Florida, I'd have to be going like Limp Bizkit, Flo Rida, Two Live Crew. No. I got to give the easy win here to Texas in the music department. And the last category I'm going to be comparing are the sports teams. And in Florida, you've got three Super Bowl champions, two with the Miami Dolphins, one with Tampa Bay, and yeah, the Buccaneers won a Super Bowl. You've also got two World Series championships with the Miami Marlins of all teams. You've got a Stanley Cup with the Tampa Bay Lightning. And you've got three NBA championships with the Miami Heat. So a lot of championships with the Florida teams. In Texas, you've got five Super Bowl championships, all with the Dallas Cowboys. You've recently had their first World Series championship with the Houston Astros in 2017. The Dallas Stars won the Stanley Cup. And there are eight NBA championships between the Texas teams. Five with the San Antonio Spurs, two with the Houston Rockets, one with the Dallas Mavericks. So Texas gets the easy slam dunk victory here, pun intended. You add it all up and the winner is Texas. With the economy, the GDP, the companies headquartered there, the music, the food, the sports, there's just too much going on in Texas for Florida to keep up with. But don't worry, Florida, you could probably beat Alabama in a competition. Maybe. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please give me a thumbs up to let me know you approve. And if you're interested in geographical stuff, some nerdy stuff about U.S. travel and cross-country road tripping, consider subscribing to this channel because that's the kind of stuff that I'm posting. But yeah, thanks for watching. Geography King signing out, singing All My Exes Live in Texas. That's why I'm living in Tennessee.